السلام عليكم. I'm Professor Dr. Haider Jawad Mubarak. I will present the fifth lecture about anatomy of the thorax, and this lecture will be about the inside of the heart, which is called interior of the heart. When you will open any of the surfaces of the heart by a scissor or a scalpel, you will see the inside of the chambers of the heart. The inside of the right atrium, left atrium, the inside of the right ventricle, left ventricle. So as in this figure, the figure shows an incision into the anterior sternocostal surface of the heart. Specifically, this incision is done in the wall of the right atrium. You will see the inside of the right atrium by now, but before I will describe the cavity of the inside of the right atrium, I want to tell you that in every part of the inside of the chambers of the heart, you will find that the two atria and the two ventricles are formed of a smooth region and a rough region. So, in regard to the right atrium, you can see that the posterior wall of the interior of the right atrium is smooth. This posterior part or posterior wall of the right atrium, which is the smooth part, shows the opening of the superior vena cava above and the opening of the inferior vena cava below. And you can see that this smooth part also shows the opening of the coronary sinus of the heart, which is the main vein of the heart. This opening of the coronary sinus, the great vein of the heart, lies in the left side of the posterior smooth part, near the valve separating the right atrium from the right ventricle. While the interior wall of the interior of the heart, which is reflected here, is rough, not smooth like the posterior part. And this roughness is due to presence of muscle ridges that are called musculi pectinate, that extends inside the auricle of the right atrium. This part is called auricle of the right atrium. It contains also pectinate, rough muscles, just like the interior part of the wall of the right atrium. And you can see that there is a ridge, a vertical ridge, separating the posterior smooth part of the right atrium from the interior rough part. This ridge is called crista terminalis. This ridge is seen from inside. If you look to it from outside on the outer surface of the right border of the heart, you will see this ridge appearing like a shallow groove, which is called sulcus terminalis. But from inside, it appears as a ridge, which is called the crista terminalis. In addition to the posterior smooth part of the right atrium and the interior rough part of the right atrium, you can see that in the smooth part there is a fossa, which is this one, representing the region of the septum separating the cavity of the right atrium from the cavity of the left atrium. So if you open this fossa, you will pass directly into the left atrium. This fossa is called fossa ovalis. And anatomically, the center is called fossa ovalis, while the margin of the fossa ovalis is called limbus fossa ovale, or sometimes the fossa is called annulus ovalis. The margins is called annulus ovalis, not limbus fossa ovale. Therefore, if there is a question in terms of enumerate opening of the scene inside the interior of the right atrium, you will say that there is an opening above for the superior vena cava. This opening have a surface anatomy and being lying opposite to the third right costal cartilage, and it has no valve here. And there is an opening inferiorly for the inferior vena cava with the surface anatomy opposite to the right 6 costal cartilage, and it has a partial valve or rudimentary valve. In addition, there is an opening for the coronary sinus, which is the main vein of the heart. This opening of the coronary sinus lie in between the opening of the inferior vena cava and the opening leading to the right atrium, which is right there, which is called the tricuspid opening or orifice containing tricuspid valve. So the opening of the coronary sinus lie between the opening of inferior vena cava and the tricuspid valve, and it is guarded by valve. And this valve is a functional valve, while the others are the valve of the inferior vena cava is weakly functioning, and the superior vena cava has no valve. In addition to these three openings seen in the cavity or the interior of the right atrium, there are many depressions, for example, this one, or depressions or openings into the wall of the right atrium from inside. Even in the rough part, you may see a small opening. These are opening of valves of veins, which are called anterior cardiac veins, and other veins, which are called venae cordis minimi, that will be considered later on. The anterior cardiac vein and the venae cordis minimi are many veins that are open directly into the cavity of the right atrium. This is all about the description of the anatomy of the interior of the right atrium. So now we will describe anatomy of the inside of the right ventricle. Again, this is the anterior sternocostal surface. The previous figure was opened right there in the right atrium. This is the right auricle. And now the same anterior surface, which is a sternocostal surface, is opened there to show the right ventricle, to show the inside of the right ventricle. And again, you can see that the right ventricle, as I said, is formed of an upper smooth part and a lower rough part. The upper smooth part is called infundibulum of the right atrium. And above this smooth part is the valve of pulmonary trunk. So the infundibulum leads to the pulmonary valve, and after which there is a pulmonary trunk. The lower rough part of the right ventricle shows many muscles that are collectively called trabeculi carinae. The arrangement of the trabeculi carinae will be in form of ridges, just like the pectineal muscle, or the trabeculi carinae will be just like bridges, or the trabeculi carinae will be in form of papillary muscles that are looks just like papilla or the nipple. The papillary muscles are attached to the wall of the right ventricle from one side And the apex of the papilla is attached by cords that are called cordi tendini, the cords anchoring the papillary muscles with the tricuspid valve, with the cusps of the tricuspid valves. The papillary muscles of the right ventricle are one anterior and one posterior, or called postero-inferior, and many other subtle, small subtle papillary muscles that are attached to the septum, separating the right ventricle from the left ventricle. So these small muscles are the many small septal papillary muscles. In addition to these features, we can see a band of muscle, which is this band, called moderator band. This band is a muscular band extending from the interventricular septum, separating the right ventricle from the left ventricle, from one side, and is attached to the base of the anterior papillary muscle on the other side. This band, the moderator band, contains part of the conducting system of the heart that will be considered soon, which is called right branch of bundle of AV bundle. The upper smooth infundibulum of the right ventricle is separated from the lower rough part of the right ventricle by a ridge, which is this ridge. This ridge is called supraventricular crest. Again, if you want to enumerate openings in the right ventricle, you say you have atrioventricular, the right atrioventricular opening, which is called also tricuspid opening, connecting the right atrium with the right ventricle. This opening, as we said before a while, is surrounded by the fibrous ring of the fibrous skeleton, and it contains three cusps, anterior, posterior, and septal. And you can see corda tendini connected or connecting the cusp of tricuspid valve with the papillary muscles. In addition, the right ventricle shows above the infundibulum the pulmonary valve, which is sometimes described as a semilunar valve, and it formed, it contains also three cusps, which are two anterior cusps and one posterior cusp. The wall of the pulmonary trunk, just above to the cusp of pulmonary valve, is slightly dilated, and each dilatation above the cusp is called a sinus. So we have two anterior pulmonary sinuses and one posterior pulmonary sinus. Now we will consider the cavity of the left atrium, which is the posterior surface or base of the heart. If you will open the left atrium from behind, again you will find that most of the left atrium is a smooth part, in which we have four pulmonary veins opened into it, except or apart from the auricle of the left atrium, which could be seen here from behind. And as you know, the auricle of the left atrium is also seen anteriorly on the sternocostal surface. The only rough part in the left atrium containing pectinate muscle is the auricle. The auricle of the right atrium, which is this one, also contains pectinate muscle. But pectinate muscle in the right atrium is also seen in the anterior wall, while in the left atrium, all the left atrium is smooth, apart from the left auricle, or the auricle of the left atrium, that contains pectinate muscle, and so it is a rough part. And you can see that the four pulmonary veins opening into the smooth part of the left atrium shows no valves at their opening. Finally, we can open the left ventricle to see the inside of the left ventricle. First, you have to say that the walls of the left ventricle are much thicker than that of the right ventricle. Number one, and number two, in a cross section, you may find that the cavity of the left ventricle is circular. Again, the upper part of the left ventricle is smooth and is called vestibule of the aorta. And above it is the aortic sublunar valve that leads to the ascending aorta. While the lower part is rough, contains muscles that are called the trabeculae carinae. And again, trabeculae carinae are in form of ridges, bridges, and papillary muscles. The papillary muscles in the left ventricle are only an anterior and posterior papillary muscles. The apex of these papillary muscles again are connected by cords that are called cordae tendini to the cusp of mitral valve that leads to the left atrium. And thus, opening in the left ventricle include the mitral valve, which is left atrioventricular valve, that lies between the left atrium and left ventricle. This valve is narrower than the tricuspid valve, has only two cusps, and the cusps are larger in size and stronger compared to the valves, to the cusp of tricuspid valve. The aortic seminal valves are seen above the smooth upper part of the left ventricle. Again, they are semilunar, contains three cusps, and they lead to the ascending aorta. And again, dilatation in the wall of the ascending aorta above each cusp of aortic seminal valve forms sinuses. The cusp of seminal valve are one anterior and two posterior, and thus the sinuses are one anterior and two posterior. This is a view from above to the cusp of aorta, of the aortic valve, and the cusp of the pulmonary trunk. And this is the opening of the superior vena cava. This is a sagittal section to show the septum between the right and left atria, between the right and left atria, and the septum between the right and left ventricles. You can see that the ventricular septum is thin above and thick below. The small upper part of the interventricular septum is thin and is called membranous interventricular septum. All the other part of the interventricular septum is thick and is called muscular interventricular septum. You can see that the wall of the left ventricle is thicker in comparison to the wall of the right ventricle. Finally, I will talk about the conductive system of the heart. What is the conductive system of the heart? You have to know that in physiology, all of the muscle of the heart is able of creating electrical impulses. So if you take any part of the heart, the muscle of that part is able to create electrical impulses. But the regular heartbeat is controlled by the region of the cardiac muscle that creates the more rapid electrical impulses, the more rapid rhythm of electrical impulses. So here we have a region which is called sinoatrial node. This region lies in the wall from inside of the right atrium, in the upper part of the crista terminalis, which is the ridge between the rough anterior and the smooth posterior part of the right atrium. About this region, the upper part of crista terminalis. In anatomy, in gross anatomy, you're not able to see here any node, although it is called, this region is called the SA node, the sinoatrial node, but anatomically, in gross anatomy, you'll not be able to see any difference in this region that make it a frank node, but histologically, you may find some changes in histological sections. This region, the upper part of crista terminalis, which is the sinoatrial node, will create electrical activity higher than any other region in the heart. So electrical activity from this node is called the pacemaker of the heart, the regulator of the heart. Electrical activity will spread from this node to both right atrium and left atrium. But unfortunately, because of the four rings of the cardiac skeleton, of the fibrous skeleton of the heart, electrical activity, after being spread from this node to the atria, to the right and left atria, is not able to be transmitted to the ventricles, the right and left ventricles, because the fibrous skeleton act as an insulator, preventing electrical impulses generated from this node passing into the atria from being passing to the ventricle. The cardiac skeleton, the fibrous skeleton, is an insulator between the atria and the ventricles. Therefore, there is another region which is called atrioventricular node that lies around there in the lower part of the interatrial septum. Remember that this fossa, the fossa ovalis, represents the region of the interatrial septum. So the lower part of this region, which is the lower part of the atrial septum, here histologically you may find a node which is called atrioventricular node or AV node. Electrical activity, after being spread from the sinoatrial node into the atria, will be collected by this node, the atrioventricular node. And from this node, there will be a bundle which is called atrioventricular bundle. That bundle will perforate the fibrous skeleton of the heart, and thus it will transmit the electrical impulses from the atrioventricular node to the ventricles. The figure here shows the atrioventricular node, which is collecting impulses from the atria, and also shows the atrioventricular bundle that perforates the fibrous skeleton to transmit impulses into the ventricles. You can see that the atrioventricular bundle, the AV bundle, runs in the membranous thin interventricular septum, and when the bundle reaches the thick interventricular septum, the bundle will be divided into right and left branches of atrioventricular bundle. Sometimes the atrioventricular bundle is called the bundle of His, and the right and left branches are called right and left atrioventricular branches of bundle of His. And the right branch of bundle of His is seen in the moderator band, seen in the cavity of the right ventricle, extending as a band of muscle between the interventricular septum and the root of the papillary muscle, and we had just described this. You must remember that all these parts of the conducting system of the heart are cardiac muscles, just like any other of the cardiac muscles, the SA node, the atrioventricular node, the bundle of his and the branches, but they are specialized cardiac muscles able of creating electrical activity and transmitting this electrical activity. Then after the bundle of his, after being branched, this is the moderator band containing the right bundle of his, will convey electrical activity to the subendocardial plexus and leading to contractions of the ventricles. This is also a magnified figure for the conducting system of the heart. Thank you very much.